Okay, so the first question on the midterm is really about setting you up to push arrows correctly. So most of the time when you have a pair of reactants and you have to show a mechanism, you don't necessarily know the products. You go step by step to get there. In this question, we give you a pair of reactants and products, and you just need to figure out what the bonding changes are and push the arrows to get from reactants to products. Now, remember that curly arrows are showing the movement of a pair of electrons. We can also show movement of single electrons. We use a different kind of curly arrow, one with a single, we call them fish hooks. The double-sided curly arrows are for moving pairs of electrons. So in all of these problems, you're moving pairs of electrons. Whenever you start a reaction and you're doing a mechanism, you always need to start at an electron source and push your arrows to an electron sink. There may be more than one arrow, there may be two or three arrows. But you always start at a pair of electrons and move to an electron sink. So always start at an electron source and move to an electron sink. In a case where you're under acid catalyzed conditions, you're going to have a lot of cations. So you're going to your arrows are going to end up at that positive charge. So all you have to do in this reaction is take a look at where the bonding changes occur and where your electron source is going to be. So we see when we go from reactants products, we have a single carbon-hydrogen bond here. There's hydrogens here that we haven't shown, but there's a carbon-hydrogen bond here, and specifically we're showing them, and on the product side, we formed a new carbon-hydrogen bond. Notice too that the positive charge is no longer on oxygen, it's on this carbon atom. So this seems to be our electron sink. We then just have to figure out where our electron source is, and in this case, it's this pair of pi electrons that is our electron source. We're gonna form a bond between this carbon and this hydrogen. We're actually abstracting a proton. This is really an acid-base reaction, and this is our base, and this is our acid. So we start at our electron source, in this case the pi electrons, and we point to, in this case, the proton. So we're going to abstract that proton. We're going to form a bond between here, this carbon atom, this hydrogen atom. We see that over there. And because this pair of electrons was shared between these two carbons, when we move the electrons, it's no longer being shared. They're going to, between these two carbons, it's going to be shared between this carbon and this hydrogen. So this then becomes electron deficient because it used to own 50% of that pair of electrons. Now it doesn't, so it's gone down by one unit of charge. That means it has to become positively charged. Now we're also not done because obviously, hydrogen can only have one bond, so we're forming a bond between this carbon and this hydrogen. We have to break this hydrogen-oxygen bond. And again, the electrons are going to move towards the electron sink. Now our source of electrons is in the hydrogen-oxygen bond, and they're just going to move up onto the oxygen as a lone pair of electrons. So in here, we've done all the electron movement using our curly arrows. We've formed a carbon-hydrogen bond. We broke an oxygen-hydrogen bond. I want to take a look. I'm going to go right to question 4A because this is now a reaction that's done under conditions where we have some strong base. So now we have a negative charge. Now notice your reactions are always going to be They may be under conditions where you start off with neutral products, but if you start off with a negative charge on something, you're not usually going to see something with positive charges on it. This is helpful because now we know that our electron source is probably going to be the site of a negative charge. And all we have to do now is find our electron sink. And in this instance, we know we have a carboxylic acid, so we know that we can lose this proton. So we're going to start at our electron sink, and usually it's going to be, the nice thing about reactions done under conditions where we have anions, our electron sink is most often the negatively charged species. So we're going to start there, and we're going to just pull off this proton. We look over here, we do form an oxygen-hydrogen bond, and that's what we've just done there. The electrons have reorganized from a lone pair on this oxygen to becoming involved in a bond with this hydrogen. So oxygen is now sharing that pair of electrons between the oxygen and the hydrogen atom. We have to get rid of the electrons because hydrogen can only support one bond, and we do that by simply, we do that by migrating the electrons that are in this oxygen-hydrogen bond. We can put them right up on the oxygen. Now, we do form this carboxylate. This is the negatively charged oxygen that's now being shown here. So let's take a look at another instance where we have a positively charged compound and a neutral species. Now, again, we can see our ultimate electron sink potentially, this positive charge, but if we look over at the products, now we see something interesting. We form a negative charge on the carbon in this instance, and we end up with another positive charge. So we're creating charge separation. We've discussed the fact that Grignard reagents, although it's a very polar covalent bond, we can often think of this thing as being, it reacts like a carbanion. It reacts like we have negative charge on that carbon. But in fact, it's just that it's a very polarized bond, and this is a very nucleophilic carbon. So that turns out to be our electron source. It's the electrons in this carbon-magnesium bond. And we have to form a bond between this carbon and this proton. So we start at our electron source, and we pull off a proton. We form that carbon-hydrogen bond. We see that in the methane. And we see that we have to end up with a negative charge on the carbon. So these electrons that are shared between the carbon and the hydrogen, right now there's two electrons shared. Formally, we think of carbon having one of those electrons and hydrogen the other, but they're shared between the two. And in the products, carbon will get both of those electrons, and hence it will go do a more negative charge. And there we go. We end up throwing the electrons that were in that carbon-hydrogen bond onto the carbon as a lone pair of electrons, and we have a negative charge on carbon now. In this instance, we have a positively charged species. So again, we have a positive charge. That's probably going to be our ultimate electron sink. We may push more than one arrow, but the final arrow is probably going to be a pair of electrons that end up neutralizing that oxygen. Let's take a look at the changes that occur over here. We have to find our electron source, and it's very likely either a sigma bond or a lone pair of electrons. And we see we have a lone pair of electrons on the nitrogen. And our nitrogen goes from being neutral to a positive charge. And we have a carbon-nitrogen double bond here. So we form a carbon-nitrogen bond, and we break a carbon-oxygen bond. So we just push our electrons. The lone pair of electrons on nitrogen reorganized to become part of this carbon-nitrogen double bond. They become those pi electrons. And then we also have to break, because now carbon would have five bonds if we don't break a bond, so we break this carbon-oxygen bond, and those electrons in the carbon-oxygen bond end up on the oxygen as a lone pair, and in our product the oxygen is neutral. Another comment to make here, notice that in all reactions that the sum of our charges remains the same. So here we start off we have a sum of charges that is a positive. We actually only have a positive charge, and our product's only a positive charge. Let's go back to the Illid reaction. Notice that we have the sum of our charges here is a one positive charge, and in our products we have a positive, a negative, and another positive, so the sum is also just one positive charge. Finally, what I want to look at, this is the one that I suppose is the hardest to figure out, but because we've been given the products, we can look at what new bonds have formed and what bonds that were in the reactants were broken. So immediately, I'm going to start and I'm going to look in that in the products, I form hydrogen chloride. The hydrogen and the chlorine are not bonded together in here, so we have to move an electron pair from somewhere to in between the chlorine and the hydrogen. If we look again, see what changes, we have a sulfur-chlorine bond here, and in our products, the sulfur and the chlorine are no longer neglected. So we have to break this sulfur-chlorine bond. Our sulfur-oxygen single bond, we look and we see it becomes a sulfur-oxygen double bond. And one of our carbon-oxygen bonds becomes a carbon-oxygen double bond, and one breaks. We break a carbon-oxygen bond. And finally, we break a oxygen-hydrogen bond. So how are we going to move all these electrons? Now, you can move in either a clockwise or a counterclockwise fashion, but we're going to have a series of electron movements. Our curly arrows are going to move in a circular fashion to occur so that all of these bond changes occur in one step. Because our hydrogen is bonded to an electronegative oxygen, I'm going to think of this as being a proton transfer. So my first thing I want to do is abstract this proton with a pair of electrons. And I have to break the sulfur-chlorine bond, so that's the pair of electrons that where I'm going to start. That's going to be my original electron source. And those electrons reorganize. This bond breaks, and we form a bond between this chlorine and this hydrogen. That's what we're indicating. Those two electrons migrate to here between the chlorine and the hydrogen and become a chlorine-hydrogen covalent bond. Hydrogen, as we've said before, can only have one bond, so we have to break this oxygen-hydrogen bond. And we do that by reorganizing them to form a carbon-oxygen double bond. That's going to be this bond right here. Now we also have to break this carbon-oxygen single bond because in the products, the carbon is only bonded to one oxygen. And we also see that we form this oxygen-sulfur double bond. So we're going to break these electrons. We're going to move these electrons so that we break the carbon-oxygen single bond and form a sulfur-oxygen double bond. Notice too that I only needed three curly arrows to move these. I've noticed a lot of students have been using more than three arrows. They've been moving electrons up onto the chlorine atom and then taking a lone pair from the chlorine atom and using that to form the chlorine hydrogen bond. The same thing with all of these. That's not actually a good description. A good description, all of these bond breakages and cleavages occur at the same time. We call this a concerted reaction. And there's a large increase in entropy, which helps drive this particular reaction. And there we go. That's how we push arrows.